welcome to Engage this morning. He is alive. He is alive. He is alive. We are so glad that you are here with us to celebrate that this morning. Let's join together and let's praise with everything that we have this morning. Praise in here for our risen King this morning. Hallelujah. Praise you, Jesus.
Thank you.
darkness shaking. Feel the darkness shaking. All the dead are coming back to life. I'm back to life. Feel the song awaken. All creation singing. We're alive. 'Cause you're alive. Us all up this morning. Thank you for the breath in our lungs, God. We give you praise. Thank you.
Good morning. Woo, I like that. How's everybody doing today? Good, good, good. Man, welcome to Engage, everyone, whether you've been with us for a long time or whether this is your first time here. Thank you so much for being here with us. We really do appreciate it. Can we do one thing real quick? This is the Lord's Day, and it's Resurrection Sunday, and so I think we need to just give Jesus praise. Can we do that? Can we just give him a hand of praise this morning? Amen. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you. I want to start out with a question. As during this time, as I was preparing this week, I couldn't decide, man, what direction to go. God, where do you want me to go? What do you want me to say on Easter Sunday? And I struggled and I struggled. Like, I'll be honest with you. I didn't finish this thing till yesterday about 5 o'clock, and that's very unusual for me. But I just couldn't decide, okay, God, it's Easter. Don't you want me to do something big, something huge? But this one question kept coming back to me. Who is God? Who is he? Who is God? And the reason that kept coming to me is because when we look around in our society today, when we look around the landscape of our world, we have so many different views of who God is. Is it true? We've got so many different views. I mean, listen, when God is brought up into a conversation, you don't even know what God they're talking about. It could be any God. Are we talking about the God of the Bible? Maybe the Muslim God, Allah? Maybe it's could be a Hindu God, maybe. I don't know. Shiva or Brahma or Vishnu or any of the other gods that they worship. And when you have other belief systems that say, well, I'm not really even sure that there is a God. Or if there is a God, he's really not relevant to our life. In that category, you have the New Age, you have atheist and agnostic and Buddhist. And within these major belief systems, you also have these different branches that they may even believe something different than another branch. Even in Christianity itself, man, in certain groups, they believe certain things about who God is. And so when you do a lot of research about all these different views, world views of who God is, man, it will make your head spin. Like, there's so many different views out there, it's crazy. We live in a society today, a society that's religious pluralistic. It's a pluralistic society where basically what that means is tolerance is held at a very high value. It is celebrated, but the claim to absolute truth is frowned upon. That there is no absolute truth in our world today. In fact, what they would say, a pluralist would say, let's focus on all the similarities of what we believe and forget about all the differences because they don't matter. In other words, hey, you can believe what you want to believe. I can believe what I want to believe. And we're all okay because it's all pointed to the same goal. We're all headed the same direction. And so it doesn't matter. Pluralists will say, hey, it doesn't really matter what you believe as long as you're sincere. Well, I got news for you. I sincerely believe that I drive a 2017 Dodge Challenger SRT. I sincerely believe it, but when I look out the mirror, no, it's a 2011 Dodge Durango with two car seats in the back and 100,000 miles. It doesn't matter how much I sincerely believe that that's the car I drive, it doesn't automatically make it true. Some pluralists would even say that the major monotheistic religions, in other words, the ones that believe in one God, they would say that we worship the same God, but it's just by different names. We call them something different. Now, there's many problems with that, but here's the major one, pure logic. Anyone remember the law of non-contradiction by Aristotle? Anybody? The law of non-contradiction by Aristotle. Man, nobody really? Here's the law. Nothing can both be and not be in the same respect. Nothing can be and not be at the same time. And so when we look at all these different worldviews around us and all these views of who God is, between different religions, but also the different views of God in Christianity itself. Here's the thing. God can't be and not be all at the same time. So how do we know the truth? Like, how do we know? We look at this landscape and all these views and we're like, how do I know? And some of us in here today are battling with that. You're saying, man, I hear this on one side and I hear that on the other side about God. How do I know what the truth is? You look and you see all of these different beliefs and you say, I don't know what to believe. Some of you in here, many of you I know are Christians. You believe that Jesus is God. But here's the thing, many of you are questioning. Many of you are saying, well, I say I believe, but do I really believe? And you're like, I don't know what to believe. These people over here believe this about God, and these people believe over here about God this. And so I don't know. And here's the thing, every group has convincing arguments when you sit back and listen to them. They're convincing. Every group sells their beliefs of God very well. So what's the truth? How do we get to the bottom of what's true? It's kind of like a buffet. Anybody in here like to eat at a buffet? Come on, a few people. Come on, y'all my people. I like buffets, man. It's good stuff. Now, who in here does not like, you hate buffets? Yeah, because you're thinking about all them people and you don't know what they've been touching and all that stuff. I get it. I get that. Here's the thing. Most people who like buffets, you know why they like them? They can get a little bit of this, they can get a little bit of that, and that, and they can try it out. That's the first course. You're just checking things out. Then the second course, ooh, I like that, like that. That's what I'm going back. That's your actual dinner, the second course, right? Some of us do the same thing when it comes to our belief in God. We're looking at the buffet of all the beliefs around, and we're doing a little bit of taste testing. We're like, oh, that's really good. Like, I like that. That tastes so good. I think I'll have a little bit more of that. And then we say, well, I like that belief too. That really fits me. So I think I'll have a little taste of that too. But then we get to a truth in Scripture that we don't like, and we say, whoa, that's nasty. And we spit it out. We're like, no, I believe this, this, and this, but I'm not so sure about that one. And what ends up happening is our belief system ends up being developed based on what we desire. Our belief system starts to be developed on what tastes good to us, what goes down well rather than the truth. We get to that place of forget truth. Just give me what tastes good. Give me what I like. It's kind of like liver mush. They're like, well, liver mush? Liver mush ain't on a buffet. Y'all ain't been to some of the buffets I've been to. Liver mush. Who in here loves liver mush? Fry it up crispy. Oh, y'all nasty people. Woo! People in the South love fried liver mush. I don't know what it is. We like it crispy. For me, I'll be honest with you, it's all right. I like it okay. I can eat it if I have to. If I'm starving to death or something, I'll eat it. But for those of you that really like this stuff, have you ever read the ingredients on the package? Shoot, no, you ain't going to. Please don't. You won't eat it again. Have you ever watched the way it's made? Ooh. Don't ever do it. You'll never eat it again. And here's the thing. You don't want to know. You don't want to know the truth because that stuff is good. And so you don't want to know what the ingredients is or the truth because all you need to know is it tastes good in the mouth. By the way, it is called liver mush. Just live and I don't get y'all. Then you've got things like hot dogs. Woo! Them are good too. I know I like hot dogs, they're good, but I don't want to know how they're made. I don't. Then you got McDonald's burgers. Yeah, uh-huh. And them chicken nuggets that they use, like they squirted it from a tube. How do they squirt chicken into a nugget? I don't know how that works. But when it comes down to what we like to eat, we don't care to know the truth. We don't care to know the origin. All we care about is the way that it tastes. And when it comes to our belief in God, many times we believe what we want to believe regardless of whether it's the truth or not. See, here's the thing. Are we Christians and non-Christians? Are we seeking truth? Or are we just seeking what makes us feel better at the time? Are we seeking what makes us feel better about the life that we're living? Y'all, we do this all the time in Christianity, and you don't even know it. You don't even realize it. I hear people say all the time, now get this, and I'm not bashing you. This is what we say all the time. They say, I just like to focus on God's love and grace and acceptance. That's it. I don't like anything else. Listen, can I be honest? I like that part too. I really do, but here's the thing. There's another side of the story. I hear people say, I don't like to think about hell or the possibility of anyone ever going there. I got news for you. I don't like thinking about it either, but it doesn't mean that it doesn't exist. See, we do this too when people in our life that we love, when they die, we say something like this. He's in a better place, right? We say that. He's in a better place. He's not suffering anymore. And I get that, and I really hope that that's true. I hope that's the truth. But do you realize we say that about people that have no evidence of ever knowing Jesus? And I know why we say it, because it comforts us. It comforts our family. It comforts the people who have the lost loved one. And so I know why we say it, but here's the thing. Would we rather seek truth or search the buffet to find out what tastes better? Turn with me to 2 Timothy chapter 4. You're like, when's he going to get to Scripture? I'm here. 2 Timothy chapter 4, verse 3. Now, I read this recently, so if it looks familiar, it's because I did read it recently. God just laid this on my heart. You ready? It says, for the time will come when men will not put up with sound doctrine. Instead, to suit their own what? Their desires, what they want, they will gather around them a great number of teachers to say what their itching ears want to hear. They will turn their ears away from the truth and turn aside to myths. Listen, don't you think that time has come? The time has come where we accept what works best for us. Well, God, I like that, and I like that. The time where we pick what fits our lifestyle. We just pick what fits our schedule and our lifestyle rather than letting the truth shape our lives. See, we live in a time where absolute truth has become a fairy tale in our society. Now today we could talk about God all day long. I could talk to somebody from another religion about God, and we could discuss and we could have spiritual conversations, and it never become controversial until I mention the name of Jesus. Uh-oh. When I mention the name of Jesus, it changes things. Why is that? Why does that name, the name of Jesus, bring up so much controversy? Is it because there's so many people out there that debate that Jesus ever walked the earth? Is it that they debate that he never existed? Believe it or not, no. Any rational thinking person would say, yes, there was a man named Jesus who walked the earth. Most historians and scholars will tell you throughout the centuries, they will tell you, yes, they believe there was a man that existed named Jesus. And y'all, I'm not talking about just Christians either. There are too many writings that are out there recorded about him, even outside of Scripture, for that not to be a fact. Here it is. Jesus was a real man, and he walked the earth. He walked the earth. Now, let me ask you this. Anyone like history? We got any historians, history buffs? Okay, a few. Don't tell me if I'm wrong, all right? Tell me after the service. I'm going to give you a quick history lesson. You ready? I want you to look up these two guys later. We're not going to talk in great detail, but I want to at least mention them. One guy, and I'll try my best to get these names right, Half of you will probably laugh at me. I don't even know if I can say it. You ready? One guy which is considered one of the best Roman historians ever. His name is Cornelius Tacitus, I think. Cornelius Tacitus. This guy lived from 56 A.D. to 120 A.D. Now realize Jesus died somewhere between 30 A.D. and 33 A.D. And so this guy that I'm talking about right now, this guy lived just a few years after Jesus, which means this. This is important. Many of Jesus' disciples, the people that he talked to, that he walked with every day, those people were still alive and around when Tacitus was around, when he was alive. Let me tell you something else very important about this guy. It is very clear from his writings, this historian was not a follower of Jesus. Very plain and simple. He was not a follower of Jesus, and so that means this. There should be no bias in his writing. Because here's the problem. Most people will say, well, you just get your information from the Bible about Jesus, that it's nowhere else recorded. No. This historian was not a Christian, and so there should be no bias. Now listen to this. Another guy. Now I'm going to really struggle with his name. Another guy. Flavius Josephus. You ever heard of him? Josephus. I'd heard him, but I didn't know his first name. And let me tell you something. Please don't ever name your kid that, because I'm sure he got made fun of a lot. I just call him Flavor Flav. But listen, he was a first century Jewish scholar and historian. He was a Jewish priest. Now that means right away, knowing that he was a Jewish priest, that he was definitely not a follower of Jesus Christ. Now get this. He was born in Jerusalem just a few years after Jesus' crucifixion. He lived actually from 37 AD to 100 AD. Man, this stuff right here gets me so excited because I'm fixing to tell you what their writings have said about Jesus. Both of these historians' writings shows evidence that Jesus walked the earth. Now check this out. This is what we get. These are outside of Scripture. Number one, the first thing we get from the writing is this. He existed as a man. Amen? He existed as a man. Number two, we get this from the writings. And I'll tell you to go do the research yourself. His personal name was Jesus. Number three, I really like this one. They say they called him Messiah. This is a non-Christian, and he said they called him Messiah. Number four, the fourth thing we see from the writing, he had a brother named James. We see that in Scripture, that he had a half-brother named James. Number five, he won over both Jews and Gentiles. And that's a pretty important detail that you can really only find in Scripture, but they're saying that this happened. Number six, Jewish leaders had unfavorable opinions of Jesus. Man, that's a pretty important detail as well. Number seven, it gets better. Pilate was the one who rendered the decision of Jesus' execution. Number eight, his execution was by crucifixion. If that does not amaze you, if that is not proof that there was a man named Jesus that walked the earth, I don't know what else will. And everything in their writings that is outside of the Bible, please remember that, it's outside of the Bible, everything that they wrote about is in line with what the Gospels are writing about. See, the controversy of Jesus is not about his existence. That's not the controversy. But this is where the real controversy comes in about Jesus. John chapter 14, verse 6. I know all of you know it. John chapter 14, verse 6. This is what Jesus said about himself. And I want you to help me because I know you know it. I am the, and the, and the. No one comes to the Father except through me. This is what caused all the controversy. See, Jesus had an exclusive claim. And that's what was so controversial back then when Jesus was around, and that's what's still controversial today in a pluralistic world. That Jesus, which we have proof that he existed, he claims to be the only way, the only truth, and the only life. Jesus claimed to be God himself. See, he didn't claim just to be a prophet. Muhammad claimed to be a prophet. He never claimed to be divine or to be God, but Jesus claimed himself to be divine and to be God. Now see, I still think you're not convinced that this is the bread on the buffet that you should be chewing on. See, there's prophecies all throughout Scripture. And what you've got to understand about these prophecies were about Jesus' miraculous birth. It was about Jesus' life. It was about his death and his resurrection. And this is what I need you to understand about these prophecies. These prophecies were written between 500 and 1,000 years before Christ ever came. It's pretty amazing. And that's not thus saith the Bible. That is dating. They were back 500 to 1,000 years before Jesus ever came. And then you have the Gospels, Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John, which was written somewhere between A.D. 60 and A.D. 100, a whole millennium after these prophecies were prophesied. Listen, when you read these Gospels, it talks about the fulfillment of these prophecies that were written 1,000 years before, and they happened exactly the way that they were supposed to happen, exactly the way that they were prophesied. And what I love about the Gospels is this. It was written by four different people. Four different people explaining the exact same events taking place. These Gospels weren't even written at the same time, and they were written by four different people. And here's the thing. Let me ask you a question. People will say, oh, there's contradictions all in there. Let me ask you a question. No, there's not contradictions. There's perspective. If I were to write something about a certain event, and you were to write something, and you were to write something, and you were to write something, y'all would all see something from a little different perspective and a little bit different angle. And that's what you get from the Gospels, and that's what I love, because you see the fullness of Jesus. There is nothing in those Gospels that are contradictive whatsoever. And here's my point, y'all. If all of these prophecies that were told hundreds, even 1,000 years before his birth came true, if all of these prophecies about his birth, his life, his death are recorded coming true by four different writers in the Gospels and by secular historians, what more proof do we need? What more proof do we need? I want you to look at one prophecy. We're going to turn there. This is actually the prophecy from David about Jesus' resurrection. This was a whole millennium before Jesus was ever born. Let's turn there. Psalm chapter 16, verse 10. Psalm 16, 10 says this. For you will not leave my soul among the dead or allow the Holy One, Jesus, allow your Holy One to rot in the grave. That was a prophecy that was 1,000 years before Jesus was ever born. Now I want you to turn to Acts chapter 2, verse 22. Acts chapter 2, verse 22, as we see this thing being fulfilled. Acts chapter 2, verse 22. This is Peter. He's preaching to the crowds that are there a gospel, the very first gospel message to this crowd at Pentecost. Let's read it. Men of Israel, Peter said, listen to this. Jesus of Nazareth was a man accredited by God to you by miracles, wonders, and signs which God did among you through him, as you yourselves know. He's saying you have seen the proof. You have seen the evidence. You have seen what Jesus has done and all the wonders and things he has done. Verse 23. This man was handed over to you by God's set purpose and foreknowledge, and you, with the help of wicked men, put him to death by nailing him to the cross. But God raised him from the dead, freeing him from the agony of death, because it was impossible for death to keep its hold on him. Now guess what happens in verse 25 through 28? He brings up the prophecy that David said. David said about him, I saw the Lord always before me, because he is at my right hand, I will not be shaken. Therefore, my heart is glad and my tongue rejoices. My body also will live in hope. Check out 27 and see if it sounds familiar. Because you will not abandon me to the grave, nor will you let your Holy One see decay. You have made known to me the paths of life. You will fill me with joy in your presence. Let's keep reading verse 29. We're almost there. Brothers, I can tell you confidently that the patriarch David died and was buried, and his tomb is here to this day. David the prophet, he is still in the grave. But he was a prophet and knew that God had promised him an oath that he would place one of his descendants on the throne. Another prophecy, verse 31. Seeing what was ahead, David, he spoke of the resurrection of the Christ, that he was not abandoned to the grave, nor did his body see decay. There it is again, verse 32. God has raised this Jesus to life, and we, check this out, are all witnesses to the fact. Peter is speaking to the crowd, and what you've got to know about Peter is this. Peter and all the disciples witnessed Jesus. They witnessed him on the cross. They witnessed him go to the grave. They witnessed him and walked with him after the resurrection. How can we look at evidence like this and not believe? Let me tell you why. It's right here, 1 Corinthians chapter 1, verse 18. This is why we can look at all the evidence and not believe. For the message of the cross is foolishness to those who are perishing. For those that don't believe, for those that are not being saved, the cross is foolishness. Resurrection doesn't make sense. But to us who are being saved, who have given our life to Christ, it is the power of God. See, to those who refuse to believe over and over and over again, the cross and the resurrection is complete, utter foolishness. But when we make a decision by faith to believe in God, and when God comes and dwells inside of us, our eyes all of a sudden are open and we're able to see the truth. And we see the cross and the resurrection as the power of God. So listen to me as we're getting ready to close here in just a moment. There is a buffet of beliefs out in front of us. We have so many different worldviews and so many different things about God that people say about God. It is laid out before us. And in one of the chairs is sitting the absolute truth. The others at the table are absolutely nothing but disguises. Jesus is the only one that claimed, I am the only way. He's the only one that claimed, I am the only truth, I am the only life. And the question that I have for you today is, do you truly believe that? Do you look around at this beautiful buffet and you see all these things that might taste good to your taste buds and you say, you know what, I want that one, I want Jesus. Or are you allowing things into your life to pull you from the one absolute truth because it just tastes better? Here's the thing that I realized as I was preparing for this. Because of our nature, no matter what the truth is, we will believe what we want to believe. We as human beings, we will believe what we want to believe. It wouldn't matter if Jesus came and he stood right before us in the flesh. Some of you are sitting there, oh yeah, that'd make all the difference in the world. No, it wouldn't. It didn't when Jesus was alive. It didn't make any difference then, and it wouldn't make any difference now. And this is why. People will believe what they want to believe. This is what God said in Scripture. If you seek me, you will find me. If you seek truth, you will find truth. The problem is we're not seeking truth. Now, I realize this morning this may be a little bit of an old-fashioned message for Engage. I get it. But let me tell you something. The gospel of Jesus better never get old-fashioned to you. The gospel of Jesus should still have the same effect and same power that it's always had. Now, I want to close the same way that Peter closed in the message that he preached in Acts. So let's go there now. Acts chapter 2, verse 36 as we close out. Peter had given all the proofs and all the evidence. That's what he did. He gave all the proofs and he gave all of the evidence that Jesus is Lord. And then this is what happened. Acts chapter 2, verse 36. Therefore, I let all Israel be assured of this. God has made this Jesus, whom you crucified, both Lord and Christ. Jesus is Lord and Christ. Verse 37, when the people heard this, they were cut to the heart, and they said to Peter and to the other apostles, brothers, what shall we do? And this is how Peter responded, replied to them. Verse 38, repent and be baptized, every one of you, in the name of Jesus Christ, for the forgiveness of your sins, and you will receive the gift of the Holy Spirit. Here's what I believe today. Some of you came in questioning. Some of you came in, you're questioning, what do I believe? Like, I don't know what I should believe. You're in that place. But I believe the Holy Spirit has revealed to some of you today who Jesus really is. And I'm going to tell you just like Peter did. He says, believe, repent, and be baptized. And then you'll know the truth. Now, I realize some of you, you're believers in here. You've already accepted Christ into your life. But here's the problem. You still have a buffet before you, and you're accepting some beliefs that you shouldn't accept. You're one-sided. I like this and I like that, but I'm not taking that in. I'm going to take what's easier for me to swallow. And what I say to you is this: quit looking for what tastes the best and start seeking the truth, the absolute truth. Now, I want to read something on my phone, because I told you I really struggled with this message. I was like, God, is this really what you want me to say on Easter? Listen to what email that I read this morning. It says, as we commemorate the death, burial, and resurrection of our Lord Jesus Christ this Easter weekend, reflect on the remarkable truth that unlike many religions of the world, Christianity is uniquely rooted in history and evidence. When I read that, I was like, okay, God, I got it. It says, Jesus of Nazareth was born in Bethlehem in Judea during the reign of Caesar Augustus and was put to death under Pontius Pilate, a first century Roman governor. The proclamation of his life, death, and resurrection is validated both by credible eyewitnesses' testimony and by credible extra-biblical testimony as well. No other religion can legitimately claim this kind of support from history and evidence. I said, I got it, Lord. So I believe without a doubt that the Holy Spirit is working on somebody's heart here today, because God don't tell us to do something if he's not going to move. And so as the musicians come up, we're going to pray together. And if the Lord's spoken to you, I'll tell you this all the time. We don't always give a traditional altar call, but we want you to know that this front is open. And as we sing and as we celebrate, if the Lord's spoken to you, please come find me. I'll be up here waiting for you. Let's pray together. Dear Jesus, God, we love you today. We thank you for what you did on the cross. And we thank you, God, that you didn't stay there, but that you rose again, that you came out of the grave. And what I love is that there's evidence of that. It's not blind faith. We have evidence that you lived, you died, and you rose again. And we thank you, God, that we have that. Lord, we pray today as people have walked in from all different walks of life. Lord, I don't know what they believe today. We have some here that believe in God, but they're not really sure what to believe past that. From all different backgrounds, from other religions, people here that may be atheists and they don't believe that there is a God. Lord, I pray right now, reveal yourself to them. Open up their eyes. Help them, God, to seek out the truth. Not to just look for what makes them feel better about how they're living and what they're doing, but to seek absolute truth. Because when they do that, I know, Lord, that they'll find you. So, God, we love you. We thank you, Lord, for this time this morning. Help us to worship you now with all of our hearts. In Jesus' name, amen.
strength indeed is small. Child of weakness, watch and pray. Find in me thine all in all. Jesus paid it all. All to him I owe. Sin had left a crimson stain. He washed it white as
so good. One more time.
Jesus,
Thank you, Lord. Let's pray and we'll close. Lord, thank you, God, so much again for the opportunity just to be here and to worship you, that we get to worship the God of the universe, creator of all things. We should not be able to do that. But because of your son Jesus, we can. The curtain was ripped, and now we can approach you, God. Thank you, Lord. May we always approach you in wonder and awe, because you are the all-powerful God. Lord, if anybody here does not know you, God, we pray that they call on the name of Jesus, that they believe, Lord, and that you save them. We love you. In Jesus' name, amen. Thank you for being here this morning.